The royal family. No, not those ones. Yes, those ones. Hailed by some to be the very definition of what it means to be British. Poise, grace, decorum. Margaret, why must you insist on eating your foie gras with a bouillon spoon? It's positively uncouth.
Toodle-pip!
They're held by their supporters to be the very representation of British power, while we're simultaneously assured that they hold no real power or sway over our democracy. We're told that they represent British sensibility and dignity, except for when they befriend convicted child sex traffickers. Now, you might be wondering why I've decided to get all pissy about this bunch of inbred fart-sniffing scroungers. Well, it comes off the back of recent news that King Charles is due a pretty substantial pay rise in 2025. By substantial, I mean 45%. And by 45%, I mean it's set to rise from £86 million per year to £125 million per year. But geez, why is that, I hear you ask? Well, the royals have explained that the increase is because the king needs more money to, cue the world's smallest violin, complete essential repairs on Buckingham Palace. I don't know about you, but my heart bleeds for them, it really does. Now, I know what you're thinking, and yes, I'm afraid it's as serious as it sounds. The fountain of Châteauneuf du Pape in the grand entrance runs dry. The ensuite shitter has been clogged by a Queen Elizabeth monster turd since 2018, leaving our noble king a mere 77 bathrooms to choose from. It's an absolute fucking disgrace. But before we get too far into the details, let's get up to speed on just how the royal family is funded and what assets they have at their disposal. For those that don't know, the royal family has three main sources of income. Number one, the sovereign grant. The sovereign grant is a percentage of the revenue generated from the Crown Estate. The Crown Estate is the name of the corporation that manages the shit that the king owns. I won't dwell on the argument that he owns about as much of the Crown Estate as I fucking do, because, you know, we've all got shit to do, but best guesses put the value of the estate at around £15.6 billion. The sovereign grant was originally set at 15% of all profits accrued by the Crown Estate, but 6 years ago it was increased to 25% to cover the cost of repairs to Buckingham Palace. It remains 25% to this day, and was intended to be reduced back down in a few years once repairs were complete. Bear that in mind for later. 2. The Duchy of Lancaster and Cornwall. A duchy, simply put, is the territory of a duke or duchess. They make up around 180,000 acres of land between them and are worth well over £1.5 billion. As with most land assets, they each tend to generate their own revenue. The Duchy of Cornwall generated about £24 million last year, and the Duchy of Lancaster pulled in about £26.2 million. The money made from the duchies are treated as personal profits owned by Prince William and King Charles respectively, and as such, it can be spent however they wish. They don't have to report how it was spent, and although they do pay taxes on the earnings, this is a matter of courtesy. They aren't legally required to do so, and can withdraw it at any point without consequence. Thirdly, private wealth. Each member of the family is, of course, permitted to generate their own wealth as they like. You know, just so long as they aren't doing anything mental like taking £500,000 worth of bribes for access to Prince Andrew and his network of Saudi oil barons and child sex traffickers. By the way, now's as good a time as any to remind you that Prince Andrew still lives in a 30-room royal mansion and is given £249,000 a year by the king. Anyway, getting back on track, King Charles's net worth is thought to be around £1.8 billion. That's mostly made up of his various estates, art collections, jewellery, racehorses, cars, and other riches bestowed upon him by the Queen at her death. Since the majority of these assets were inherited from the Queen, he has paid, say it with me, fuck all in taxes. So, to recap, that's three sources of income: the sovereign grant, the duchies, and personal wealth. We know that between the duchies and the sovereign grant, they make at least £126 million a year. Now, as I said earlier, the amount the king currently receives through the sovereign grant is 15% of what is generated by the crown estate, plus an extra 10% that was added to help with repairs. That 26% comes in at a grand total of £86.3 million. Now, one thing that makes up part of the crown estate is the seabed. Mental, I know, but stick with me. As offshore wind farms are built to create a source of renewable energy, the amount of money generated by owning the seabed has increased dramatically. In response to this sudden surge of financial wealth, the royal trustees sought to recalculate the sovereign grant. Sounds reasonable, right? You just adjust the percentage down to whatever allows him to keep receiving whatever he currently receives. Job done. Now, if I were to tell you that the royal trustees were Rishi Sunak, Jeremy Hunt, and some bloke called Mike whose job it is to look after the royal family's money, you might suspect that something a bit dodgy was going on. And you'd be absolutely cocking right. If you read the government's announcement regarding the change to the sovereign grant, it's been framed as though the grant is being decreased. And while it's true that it will be changed from 25% down to 12%, the sum of money that they actually receive is vastly increasing. Let me read out the government's announcement of the change. The sovereign grant is to be set to 12% next year, down from 25%. This change comes from a significant increase in the Crown Estate's profits from offshore winds. As a result, the royal household's budget will be £24 million lower next year, and £130 million lower in both 2025 and 2026 than if it remained at 25%. Now again, bearing in mind that our Prime Minister pledged to return integrity to his role, I implore you to read this announcement in full and ask yourself, is this the most clear and the most transparent he could have possibly been in communicating that the monarch will be receiving a 45% increase in the amount of money that he receives? Bear in mind also that they're using the 25% figure rather than the original 15%. They're trying to justify the increase in pay as being for essential repairs to Buckingham Palace, but they've already been receiving 66% more funding from the sovereign grant for essential repairs to Buckingham Palace. I'm not saying they can't make essential repairs, but they're already receiving tens of millions of pounds extra every year to cover these costs. While the majority of pro-royal media have kept shtum about this, our friends at GB News have unironically written this. The sovereign grant will have remained flat at £86.3 million for 4 years, which is actually a cut in real terms, given inflation. That's right, despite condemning rail workers, teachers, and nurses for demanding a few percent to be able to, you know, feed their children, GB News is all for justifying a pay rise for the billionaire benefit-scrounging palace dwellers, because how in their right mind could they possibly put maximum effort into going abroad and shaking hands with people on just £125 million a fucking year? It never fails to shock me how conservatives turn into Karl Marx when it comes to the royal fucking family. Oh, but geez, they need their money to do their job. No. Sorry, mate. Don't fucking believe it. Even the idea that we need them to perform royal duties is entirely self-imposed. If we have any governmental business worth dealing with, we should be represented by our elected leaders to represent the views and interests of the people who voted for them. The way they boldly and bravely take private jets to tour the Caribbean isn't something I feel provides a huge amount of value to the British people. Then we have other ceremonial events, like the coronation. Charles was already king. It was 100% a ceremonial event. And it's not as if he jumped in his Civic and drove home at the end of it. He was escorted home by basically the entire fucking army while he rode in a chariot coated in gold. The same with the Queen's funeral. It's not like they all just met down the creme, said a few nice words, and popped down to the Nag's Head for a knees up. These all had cost implications for the taxpayer to the tune of millions of pounds. Now let's just take a moment to refresh our memory on what King Charles actually owns. He owns a fleet of around 23 vehicles valued in excess of £6 million. He owns Balmoral, a private family retreat in Scotland, now famous as the place where the Queen died. It comprises Balmoral Castle and approximately 53,000 acres of land surrounding it. It's valued around £80 million. The Sandringham Estate in Norfolk, another big fuck-off house with almost 16,000 acres of land at its disposal and is valued conservatively at £250 million. 4. The Royal Stud. No, the stud is what they call the place where they keep horses. The Queen was actually quite keen on breeding big stallions, stop it, and her horses were valued somewhere in the nay, the hood, of £27 million. 5. The Royal Philatel is a fucking stamp collection, okay? It's a really big, really old stamp collection and has been valued at the very least, £100 million. 6. Artwork. The royal family unsurprisingly owns a bunch of art, some of which was gifted and some that was purchased privately by members of the family over the years. The value of the collection is estimated to be somewhere in the tens, if not hundreds, of millions of pounds, but there's no real way to tell the true value. 7. Jewelry. As with all good villains, they are utterly obsessed with shiny stones and precious metals. Experts have valued 54 pieces of the family's private collection at around £530 million, and it contains such pieces as the not-at-all-controversial Kohinoor diamond. You know, that important piece of Indian history that the British monarchy forced a 10-year-old boy to hand over to them in an act not at all dissimilar to stealing. While the opportunity for restitution by handing the artifact back over to the Indian people has always been available, our noble and honourable heads of state have decided instead, fuck it, we'll just keep it. Truly a bunch of national treasures. Sorry, cunts, I mean a bunch of cunts. 8. Investments. The royal family's investment portfolio is extremely secretive and so, it's hard to put an exact figure on just how fucking minted they are. With that being said, back in 1993, a group of journalists from The Times scoured the FTSE 100 companies to find information about their holdings. Back then, they estimated that the monarch held around £43 million. If they did simply hold what they were thought to have owned back then, those same holdings now would be worth in excess of £118 million. Number 9. Swans. Weird one, but stick with me. The monarch has the right, by law, to claim ownership of all mute swans swimming in open water on unmarked public land. I'm sure you're thinking, oh, but that's because the lovely old queen really liked swans. No, no it's not, my sweet, sweet summer child. It's because they used to be a delicacy back in the day and the monarchs wanted all the yummy, tasty, juicy swans all to themselves. Now, according to birdfact.com, there is a minimum of 7,000 breeding pairs of mute swans in Britain. Given that the average mute swan weighs around 11 kilos, the king could possibly lay claim to 77 tons of swan. Now that's a lot of swan. I'll stop there, but you get the point, right? The monarchy has absolutely every financial, social, and legal advantage that they possibly could. Why are they not expected to utilize their own assets to help cover unexpected costs on their own homes? When I need to replace my sex swing, I can't just petition the council. Guess who's having to pay for that? Muggins here. That's fucking who. And while I'm struggling to afford my matching Swarovski butt plug and ball gag, these cunts are turning cap in hand to the government to get new lifts installed in fucking East Wing. Let me finish by reminding you of the context surrounding this story. We are fresh off the back of a worldwide pandemic that crushed our economy and destroyed what little trust was left between the people and the politicians that represent them. Those that we celebrated as key workers just 2 years ago are now being vilified by our own Prime Minister simply because they're trying not to fall below the poverty line. Whenever the case is made to improve the lives of those struggling in this country, our government will laugh in our faces and will smugly announce that there is no magic money tree. And yet, here we are stuffing the pockets of billionaire welfare frauds. And for what? Because their great-great-great-great-grandfather killed someone wearing a fancy hat in Hastings. Mental. It's fucking mental. Now, I'm sorry, but if I'm going to pay somebody £125 million a year and a lifetime supply of swan soup, I'm going to need a lot more from him than the state visit to Germany and an assurance that he might carry on paying some taxes. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, please consider subscribing. If you do, you can legally call yourself a geezer, and the police can't do anything about it. A big thank you to my smart and sexy supporters over on Patreon. Marie, Alex Davies, Alex Ray, Alexis Geddes, Craig Hall, Fluffy the Demon, Destroyer of Worlds, Nice, Jeffrey Anderson, Jacqueline Cowan, Lord Kitty Cat, Matthew Gray, Nicholas Ellis Brown, Oleg Vodolashki, Paul Ashworth, Rory McElhone, Shuttermask, Simon Watton, and Tommy. You guys are all awesome. If you'd like to support, you can do so from just £1 a month. The link is in the description. Love you. Bye-bye.